At this panel, we are going to have Anand from Instabase. Anand is actually also an MIT alum and a startup founder. And Sharon, VP of IBM Research, and Bingdu to help us moderate this conversation. Let's welcome all of them on stage.
Today we'll be talking about AI and enterprises and the enterprise AI revolution. And I want to start with talking about the reality versus hype in AI. I think the minute we talk about artificial intelligence, everybody is like, oh my God, that is so hyped. So, you know, with Sriram and Anand, we'll go with Sriram first. Sure. How do you think about the hype today, and what is the reality on the ground?
Excellent, excellent, pleasure to be here. I think if I had to summarize it in a sentence, I think we are in the enterprise starting to see moderation set in. And it's come through some scars, but also an understanding that, look, this stuff is still valuable. This is the way I'm going to get value out of the data that I have, but I have to think about it differently. So let's take some of the magic out. Let's understand what I have to do to get ready to get value. So we see three things that enterprises are beginning to worry about correctly to make AI real. The first is, if I'm an enterprise that existed before the recent AI revolutions, I was not born in the last 10, 12 years, I wasn't born thinking this way, what do I have to do to get my information architecture ready? And we like to joke about AI and IA being the two sides. They are starting to think about the fact that if I don't solve that, I can't get value. So a lot of the hype they didn't deliver was not because the AI didn't do its job, I didn't set the platform correctly. So that's setting in. The second discussion happening is around skills. Many enterprises cannot afford or don't have the ability to access the skills sometimes that are needed. So there's a focus on acquisition, retraining, and of course, as scientists, there's also a focus on can we do enough automation so that some of that doesn't become a problem, and we can talk about that. And I think the third that's happening is also understanding what it means to go from a POC, a proof of concept that said, well, this model does what I want, to actually scaling and operationalizing it. So data foundation, skills, and then scaling and operationalizing it. Because in most enterprises, it's not one big AI model that's going to give me $1 billion of revenue. It's a collection of hundreds of thousands of models that I have to deploy across my workflow and then starting to think about. So I think those three are moderating. But if I had to answer your question at the top, I would say, There is no lack of interest in continued focus on using AI. It's just moderated with a sense of, I need to do all this before I get there.
Great. So Anand, you are a startup founder. So you probably are seeing a lot of people who are interested in AI as well as your tool right now. How are you talking to customers with respect to how they should adopt AI?
Yeah, so we've learned some lessons from some scar tissues. So we'll talk about we always considered the world from the perspective of a problem that needs a solution, and what are the right systems to solve that problem. So for example, and I give this example a lot, which is, let's say, like, how you can say that if you apply some force on a mass, how much acceleration it would be. There is Newton's second law of motion that tells you F equal to ma. It gives you the formula where you can deterministically say, if you apply this force, you will get this acceleration. Now, there's a second way of doing the same thing. You take like millions of observations, build some AI system that will do the prediction. And I always recommend everybody that always follow Newton's second law of motion, because it's deterministic, you can explain it, and you can sort of like debug it. Now, in certain cases, there doesn't exist that law of motion. Like, for example, natural language understanding. There is no code that somebody has written like, if this, understand the speech, and you can predict this. And only way you can solve this is by sort of like, because you don't even know the different dimensions that affect those things, is you take like billions of samples and you try to build some probabilistic model that will give you the probability. So the way we try to design a system is wherever there is a possibility that we can build a deterministic approach where you can define the real algorithmic solution to solve the problem, we will take that. We'll use AI only when there doesn't exist any algorithmic solution. In fact, there was just, I'll not take the name of the company. So we were doing a presentation, we were trying to show a demo, and someone from the audience asked, so does your system use AI to come up with these conclusions? And I think my response was, and I was naive, was like, do you need the solution to your problem or do you need AI and there was silence for 30 seconds in the whole audience. But we've always taken that approach. And we always try to think any problem from the very first principle perspective. Like, this is a really, really good example. All the enterprises, if you are in trade finance, you have to deal with like understanding from where shipment moves from one country to another. So you get a bunch of documents, you have to understand like, you know, shipping address, port of loading, and all of those kind of things. And a bunch of companies try to do that by applying some AI or ML. And we took this problem, which is like, do you really need to do that? And the way we solved this is, we sort of like said, where do you find all the addresses in the world? In maps. So we'll try to, in fact, look at every single thing, go to the maps, and figure out if this belongs to part of the any address. Then you get the region out. Because once you know that, then you can figure out that, hey, if this is shipping address and the port of loading is from the same country, then most likely they're going to be like the shipper's address, even if there is no label present. I just don't believe that the AI or ML can automatically understand some of those things. So we always try to sort of like break the problem into the first principle components and try to reason about those components. And in some places, there doesn't exist a way to solve this with classical algorithmic way, and we'll go with the AI, like optical character recognition or natural language processing and some of those. But in general, I always see these as systems problems rather than AI problems. So I'm a little controversial or maybe a little old class in that way.
No, I think what you're saying is think of the problem first, right? And see if AI is the right tool for it. Don't use AI everywhere, especially when there is some deterministic way or an axiom. Okay, so that makes a lot of sense. I think a lot of enterprises, while they're you know, very excited about AI, they're also beginning to think about how to do this in a sensible, rational way. But there's also another enterprise revolution going on, at least in a few enterprises, right? There is this kind of move to the public cloud, which means all of their like IT stuff is moving. And at the same time, enterprises are getting bombarded and being told that they should adopt AI really quickly. So how should an enterprise deal with that?
Yeah. So I think we have to, most enterprises today, and the number, depending on who you count, is upwards of 70, it can be 80, 85, are always straddling multiple clouds. So this move is not a one-shot move. It's going to be a move over a period of time, and it may never be a move completely. So most enterprises have the scenario that the AI that they want to do often has to touch data living across multiple public clouds, some on-prem, some infrastructure. So this previous conversation we had around setting that information foundation is about deciding how you marry the AI that you want to do with where the data is located, and often, in enterprises, the hardest conversation is this three-way conversation between three personas. There is the data scientist or an AI developer who wants to just give me the data, I want to build my model. There is a data governance officer who is all about, no, you cannot move this data over there, this column cannot be seen, I have to, you know, to deal with those complexities. And then there is the data operator that says, this guy wants data, you're telling me I cannot do all of that, how do I set up the data pipeline to satisfy both of your needs? And today, that three-way persona conversation is highly laborious, non-automated, and really is the cause of a lot of friction, even before you get to the AI itself. So a lot of interesting work is there, and this is a scenario where you can actually use AI to address this problem. Problems of quality, optimizing data movement, dealing with security. These are all scenarios where you said, if this is the foundation I need to do AI, let's use AI to address the problem. And that's really a lot of what's happening. So it's almost like I needed to do this. Well, enterprises weren't ready because this stuff was not ready. Well, let's use AI to get them ready and then build the stuff on top. That's really the conversation happening. And the cloud adds the multi-cloud nature adds the additional complication that sometimes you may have to bring the data to where you're able to run your AI. Sometimes you got to take the AI where you can run the data. And sometimes you have to do a combination of both.
So do what makes sense for that particular situation.
Yes, but make it easy because the three personas here are not rocket scientists. Right. So a lot of it is about how do I bring the AI so that they all have their roles to do, important roles to play, but how can we remove a lot of the friction so that you don't go from AI projects taking 7 to 8 months to solve all this problem, of which modeling may be really a really small piece.
Right.
But they can actually shorten and focus on, you know, solving the problem as opposed to dealing with it.
So actually, I'll turn around and ask a different question of Anand, because he just said, hey, think about AI as a tool, not kind of, basically a means to an end, right? So, okay, a lot of times what's happening right now is enterprises are like, oh, I should adopt AI, but they don't really know how because there's so much hype about AGI, and a lot of people actually think that AI is capable of doing everything that a human can do already. So what do you think are the most interesting applications within an enterprise where they should start using AI or start thinking about building their own AI models?
There are plenty, and it all depends on the industry. At the end, what has happened is businesses, basically the way they operate, more and more things are being done by computers. And the majority of the parts of computers are just not good at making those decisions, are not really good at doing the right thing. And for example, let's take very, very simple, very, very simple example. Like reading text from the image. It's amazingly simple for humans. If I took a camera picture and sent it to you, you can read what is written on it. It's a very, very hard problem for computers. Handwriting. And for example, everybody sends this nice letter and say hey, can you do this? Or people send an email. Can you transfer this much money from this account to that account? It's very easy for humans to understand. It's very, very hard for computers to understand it because you can't write a code saying if this word is present, it might be, can you not transfer this money or whatever? And now, so what this all opens is as more and more things are becoming digital, people are basically sending emails to do the transfer, or people are sending these hey, this is my passport and driving license and whatever, can you grant me visa to government? And with artificial intelligence, I think if you can do OCR right, if you can do natural language processing right, if you can do the data extraction right, you'd be able to build these systems where now you can sort of break the bigger business problem into the set of things, understand the identity from identity documents, understand the intent from the email, and understand the the request that they're trying to make from other documents that they're submitting, and then you can automate and within 3 seconds you can approve certain things. So it all depends on the domain, but if you look at the government sector, all of these stuff, the logistics, the financial services, banking, more and more communications are happening over computers now. People are sending text messages, people are sending emails, people are uploading just the documents and expecting you to make the decisions. So there is huge opportunities, but it's not going to be that there is this AI that will solve this. It's just people still have to go and break this particular business problem into a set of individual components, try to figure out how to solve these components. And in some places, you will have to use AI. In some places, you will use the classical algorithmic way, what it is. So that's how we try to approach and we see the problems in the enterprises.
Okay, that's good. So what we're saying is, hey, depending on the problem, use AI appropriately. Classic example are a bunch of natural language types of problems. Here's a question for both of you. So we just talked about how hard it is to find good AI talent. And also there is, I would say, some confusion about the terms artificial intelligence and machine learning. I feel like the industry is just moving towards artificial intelligence, even though it's a machine learning problem, so to speak. The question really is, what should enterprises do in this case where you said, hey, it's so difficult to find good AI talent? Right? And then the examples that Anand gave were very natural language specific. Should they be really building these solutions in-house, or should they be leaning more towards buying the solutions? And if they do buy the solutions, there is so much noise in the space. There are I think 1,000 vendors right now who claim that they all do enterprise AI. How do they evaluate the right vendor for themselves?
Okay. I think the answer is going to vary over time.
Yeah.
As with many things, I think there's going to be some consolidation over time. But right now, I think depending on the use case, depending on in-house expertise, and depending on larger partnerships that enterprises have with vendors, they make different choices. But I think if you had to look at a few considerations that they may want to think about while they make these decisions, one obviously is the ability for that vendor solution to plug into the complexities of the enterprise. So vendors that offer an AI that will only work somewhere, only work in a certain infrastructure, is going to be limiting unless you are convinced you want them only in that particular business process workflow and never want them anywhere else. Because remember, as you said, enterprises' information architecture is changing. They are already in a dynamic world in which something that is happening today in one environment is going to happen in another environment tomorrow. So that's how flexible, platform agnostic is the solution that AI vendor is offering. I think the second is going to be customizability. many, many problems. Until you get into bespoke, narrow problems where out of the box it's going to work, a lot of what you're purchasing is a base capability that you're going to have to customize. And you're going to have to customize using skills that you have in the company or you have the ability to hire or, you know, partner with. So you want to then look at how effective is the tooling around the solution that lets my scientist or my engineers adapt the solution to my use case. And I think the third important consideration, which is we often forget that there is a life cycle. So it's not as if I have a problem, I decompose the problem, I identify three places where I need a model, I go build it, it's done. There is ongoing life cycle management. AI models don't continue to work perfectly. The data changes, they have to be managed, they have to be updated, they have to be revised. Today, that again is a job requiring a lot of expertise. If you don't understand how the model behaves relative to data changes, you know, so there is, I think, an opportunity, of course, for tools that address end-to-end lifecycle management. And if you are in a regulated industry, that also requires, there's an extra bar. There is this whole area of model risk management in financial services industry and other regulated industries that makes lifecycle management harder. So I think these become more important considerations beyond just the quality. The quality is granted. And of course, you know, in the academic and the science circles, we worry only about quality. But I think these are other practical considerations right. that actually make your buying decisions.
Your thoughts?
Yeah, so I'll take more from the, if you look at the evolution of computing, I think there is a one famous quote that came from Barbara Lisco, who was the first Turing Award winner from MIT. And her PhD thesis first sentence said, abstraction based on modularity is how things get done. And if you see the evolution of computers, basically, what has happened is, initially, you had to write those assembly code. Then later, we built higher level languages. Then we built the operating system where you got these entire components built out. Then, basically, we built internet where you just make the call and APIs where you can just get the whole component done. And I think similarly, what is going to happen in the future is that operating systems will evolve where you do not need the low-level raw skills, and that you're already seeing with AutoML and TensorFlow, mm-hmm. where you can just simply define your input and output specification and some configuration parameters, and system will do its job. So what is going to happen is there will be higher and higher level abstraction, which is so that the people within these enterprises will be able to build their own AI models, and those abstractions, they can assemble together to build more complex solutions. So you will see, like, you're already seeing some of the cloud vendors giving, like, NLP, as a service, or new analysis mm-hmm. as a service, or extraction as a service, or table definition as a service, whatever.
Yeah.
But eventually, what is going to happen is you'd be able to build, like the OS, you'd be able to just deploy anywhere. The OS will have, it's like iOS, right? You have accelerometer, you have camera as a service, you have GPS as a service, and you can build Uber, right? People don't need to know, like, how the movement of, like, the, you know, the horizontal axis or the vertical axis needs to happen in order to define Uber. Uber just uses accelerometer from the iOS. So similarly, what will happen is the operating system will start providing those services as part of the building block within the development environment, and anybody will be able to build those. So eventually, OS would make those as a sort of the basic building block within the system itself. That's how I see the evolution of how the computing will change eventually.
So what both of you are saying is enterprises will end up, quote unquote, buying these services, but then orchestrating them based on their own custom use case. Is that a good way of putting it?
And I think the orchestration will be more complicated now, but as some of these abstractions occur, they're going to get simpler. I think that's sort of the journey that we are on. And I think that simplification is also going to need AI.
Right.
I think that's the big pattern. What you're seeing is AI being used, whether it is in data prep, in data configuration, in data discovery, in actual modeling, AI being used to remove a lot of the complexity and high skill bar that today is needed in AI, I think you're going to see that, and that's a big pattern. And you could almost say, I mean, this sort of goes to eventually the vision of automated programming. I think we are seeing early signs of automated programming, mostly in data science, because I think that's where the AI guys are there. They say, can I remove a lot of the crud in what I have to deal with and trying to automate a lot of what they are doing? So I think that's exciting times.
Excellent. Sorry.
A really good example is Oracle database or whatever database. For example, earlier, people ended up writing their own custom way of managing everything.
Right.
What basically a standardized abstraction that came in is like, you put all the stuff and you can make a query, which is select some name from where this parameter matches. And you will see the same thing happening with a bunch of these AI systems, where you'll build these abstractions and the people can build solutions where they don't need to go into the deeper details.
Got it. Okay. So we've talked a little bit about enterprises. Now let's turn this around because I'm sure there are a lot of people in the audience who are probably startup founders or people who work at startups. And we know right now, especially, the startup revolution is going crazy as well, right? There are about, 500 to 1,000 startups started every like 3 months, I think. And half of them are AI. So now you're a startup, imagine, and you're selling to enterprises. And you just said, hey, enterprises should take into account things like flexibility, customizability, end-to-end lifecycle management and whatnot. I think a lot of startups say that they're all that. Right? How do you as a startup, or what advice do you two have for a startup who's just come out of, say, stealth or what have you, how do they distinguish themselves from everyone else at this moment? To the enterprises, of course, who are their buyers.
And I think you pick one of these axes, I think, because as a, you have to take this complex problem enterprise deal with, and you've got to be good at one to be able to distinguish. So one axis could be go bespoke to the point at which you completely solve the business problem. Then the AI is an enabler, but you're solving the business problem. And you could go that, and as long as that's a big enough market opportunity, that's one direction.
The second, build a vertical solution.
Vertical or an important enough AI model that is general enough that can be that has a big enough market. The other approach is to focus on the problems that enterprises have today. And like I said, as opposed to focusing on creating an AI that solves something, recognize a lot of enterprises are trying to use AI to solve their problems, address their pain points, use AI for better data discovery, use AI to help them in data governance, use AI to help them in setting that information architecture, AI in lifecycle management, AI in automated programming. So if you recognize that I don't have to sell my AI, enterprises, you guys are going to do AI within you. I'm going to help you remove friction from the journey. And removing that friction also involves me using AI. That's sort of a second space of opportunity, and enterprises are interested in that. The third one, of course, is, again, go lower down the stack. There's a lot of innovation, not just in the software side, end-to-end vertical integration, scaling, performance, and if you have the skill sets. So those are three areas that I can think of.
You could focus on.
You have anything? So, startups are hard. So, I don't know if I have a magic formula that will be successful if you do something. But just to get the product right, I think what Sriram said is the right one, which is figure out the problem which you can solve better than anybody else. And it doesn't matter whether you use AI or you've hard-coded everything, as long as it really solves the problem and gives the customer the value. And then eventually, under the hood, then you can change the architecture and some of those things later. But one of the lessons that sort of like I've learned from the whole, we've spent almost 3.5 years old company, is that at the end, eventually for any startup to be successful, the product needs to solve a business problem better than anybody else. And even with the AI hype and all that, you might get some customers, some trying POCs and all of that, but for long-term success, it's really, really important that figure out which problem you want to go after. Find out the enabling component, make it easiest to use, make the best experience, only if those things are right. So I would just focus on the key problem that I need to solve, nothing else. AI doesn't matter.
Got it. So product is king, which is great. That's spoken like a true startup founder. Okay, excellent. We have only time for one more question. Anyone in the audience have a question that they'd like to ask? If not, I'm happy to ask the last question. Anyone? Okay. So just to tap it off, let's just like look 10 years ahead. And I'd like each of you to like think about what the enterprise AI space is going to be, both in terms of vendors as well as enterprises itself. Are we going to have like 4 or 5 behemoths? Like, are we going to see the new AWS and the new Oracle? Or are we going to have like AWS and IBM become the big, the big AI companies? How do you see this evolving over the next 10 years?
It's a tough one to predict. But let me state it, let me answer it maybe differently. I think we're going to get to a point where it won't matter whether you are an AI company or not an AI company. I think if we believe that software has pervaded every aspect of our enterprise across many industries, every profession, every workflow, I think you're going to see AI inside. So it's almost not going to matter. It's like saying, are you an internet company or are you not? I mean, it's not a valid question. I think that's where we're going to be. So if we believe, and it's been true, that software is everywhere, I think eventually you're going to see AI everywhere to the point where it won't matter. To honest, it's going
pervasive.
To solve a problem. I think that's my definition as opposed to whether this is going to be 2 or 3 AI.
I see. Got it. Okay. Are we going to see some new companies because of the AI revolution? New big ones?
Yeah, I think there will be. So basically, I think at the very, very core platform, I don't think there will be a lot of them. There might be two, okay. three, or four. It's like Intel and the way like in the CPU and chip industry you have. Then there will be a few, not a lot, great platform companies where applications are built. And that also I don't see many of them. Because at the end, like if you have 2,000 different platforms, it's very hard for the application to support all of them. So you will have like only few winners at the lower level, CPUs and memory and all that stuff. And there will be only few players on the OS level. But at the application level, you will see thousands of companies. Because it's very, very hard for one company to solve all the application problems, right? So like there would be 100 companies that will solve some banking problem, or there'd be 100 different companies that will solve some other problem. You would not see one big company winning all that. But at the lower two level, I do see that two or three companies will dictate and will take like majority of the market share.
Great, excellent. So we live in exciting times, and hopefully a lot of things will change and evolve, and we'll see some winners soon. Thank you.
Thank you.